Should be a presenter now, Melly, and you can go ahead and take over.
Hi, can you hear me? I need to set up my connection because as far as I saw, presentations are not working. Actually, screen sharing is not working with the cable, so I need to connect to wireless.
Okay, yeah. All right. Do you need to like get off the call and come back? Hold on. Yes, I can see your screen now.
I will move just to make sure. Can you see the movements?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay, then I will begin my presentation. Hello, everyone. I'm Milos. Today, I would like to talk about my thesis, Eye Segmentation Using Deep Neural Networks. First, I would like to start with problem description. In my thesis, I wanted to segment the eye image into four regions, as you can see, iris, sclera, and pupil. The fourth region is background. That requirement actually come from a real need. In Akdeniz University Research Project 3295, we needed to follow the eye movements in semi-restricted conditions, and we wanted to create a system that automatically detects the eye movements and maybe comparing them alongside with the EEG, it means the brain signals, to see if there is any kind of pattern in children's epilepsy seizures. So in order to detect the seizures, we put the segmented eye images into brain waves to see whether if we have any kind of relation. Main purpose of this study is to see performance of the deep neural networks on the eye segmentation case. I took this opportunity to expand my questions towards the deep neural networks. I wanted to see if it matters that much, different networks' performances can affect the results that much, or how to say. You see, when you are checking and working on a project, you will see tons of different deep neural networks, and that those networks can vary from each other structurally. But when it comes to results, do them differ too much? While working on this problem, I wanted to also see that the networks I worked on my thesis are VGGNet, UNet. VGGNet is a simple network. You can think as the most basic concurrent neural network. And I will talk about them later. Maybe I should explain them later. I used them and I get some results with them. I compared them and I will share with you my findings. Firstly, I would like to talk about early iris segmentation methods. While I'm exploring the eye segmentation, we cannot talk about eye segmentation without talking about the iris segmentation, because iris segmentation is what made eye segmentation methods actually move fast, because I think 91, Dogman offered a biometric system that can identify a human using iris. And that also really increased the research about the eye and iris. Those methods are used infrared or near infrared images to segment. As you can see, those images are rather restricted in restricted conditions, and those images are rather easy to use with traditional image segmentation or edge detection methods. Dogman's method actually took advantage of the differences between the, you know, the brightness or luminative values of the pupil and the iris. As you can see, the pupil is darker and iris is brighter. So the his algorithm works like, in the image of the eye, he considers as a, each pixel of the image as a anchor point, and for these anchor points he checks the contrast differences between pixels. And let's say our center is here, and we are checking the contrast differences, we will find that here we have a great contrast differences, but let's say the value distance, the distance between my anchor point and my different contrast point is R. But if we check the other point in similar distance, we will see that contrast difference is not that great. So we can't find any circle in that aspect. But if we check the center of the iris and check a point, let's say here, we have a great contrast difference. But if we check another point with the same radius, and we will see that contrast difference is great again. So that way we can generate a circle using those points to create a eye segmentation. That method really works fairly well, but of course it has some restrictions. Also, the second method I would like to talk about, the early iris segmentation methods, is Wilde's method. Wilde's method is traditional edge detection method. It uses vertical, horizontal, and circular edge detection methods with Hough's circle detection method. Hough's circle detection method is, if you look for a circle detection algorithm, what will you see first on the internet or maybe MATLAB? It's really widely used. These methods, both of them work fairly well in restricted conditions, but they don't work as reliable when outside factors are included. They require specialized equipment like infrared cameras, and images are need to be taken stationary in certain angles. They don't work as reliable when outside factors are included. Also, human eye might seem circular, but that's not always the case. Actually, eye is not circular. It's more elliptic, and the shape may vary person to person. Also, some people have some sort of genetic or disease issues that cause them to have differently shaped pupils and irises. So these methods does not work fairly well in those conditions. Before I move to my findings, I would like to talk about the networks I use. I use two VGG unit-based networks to see whether the depth has too much effect on the results. My initial network is smaller version of the VGG net and UNet. UNet is the second part of the network. As you can see, it takes the inputs from the similar sizes or similar dimensions and uses one-time convolution to add some sort of meaning to them. It's commonly used in biometric image segmentation. And VGGNet is, as you can see, concurrent or connected deep neural network. All layers are connected between until the UNet layer. In UNet layer, we take the encoder information and convolve with the decoder information to create a new information and increase the segmentation performance. The main difference between these two networks is only the depth and the number of parameters I used. I wanted to use them as a base case because in our current day, this is as simple as you can go with the neural networks. Maybe you cannot use UNet. You can just go with the connected neural network to the end without encoder-decoder network. But that would make no sense because encoder and decoder networks are shown to be superior to the traditional connected networks. Second network I use is share the same encoder structure with the UNet. I wanted to see with the same encoder structure whether the different decoder structures create any substantial or a difference that really matters. So in this network, I used VGGNet with PSPNet. PSPNet is actually, when it's first introduced, it was a evolutionary idea because it used different pull rates to get different context from a same image. Because when you are using different pull rates, the output image you get is, the size of the output image you get is differs. So you get different parameters, you get different weights. And by combining them with concatenation, you get really rich semantic information about your segmentation. Later, that idea is evolved with the DeepLab. And I use DeepLab version 3+ because, first of all, it's what Google introduced to the deep neural network scene. It shares the idea of the PSPNet with the convolution of different rays, but it also uses something called Artorius convolution, which meaning that convolution operation is made with some empty spaces, so that when you are making a convolution operation, you are not getting as bulky as filters, and the context you get is still somehow meaningful. Which means that with Artorius convolutions, we were able to get more information with the less computational requirements. Therefore, we were able to get more context, or maybe we could go deeper in the networks. It uses also its own encoder-decoder structure. Likewise, with PSPNet, it concatenates the different convolutional rates and use them to decode a meaningful information about what we are wanting to segment. It's really a go-to network if you want to work on segmentation because it's widely documented. But it might be troublesome for people to make it work if you are not familiar with the neural networks or if you are not familiar with the deep neural network scene, because it's not straightforward as VGGNet and UNet structures. The last network I used is HRNet. Actually, before my thesis, I had no idea about the HRNet, but when I checked the benchmarks, I saw lots of HRNet results outperforming most of the networks. The idea itself is really good and, you know, really brilliant because they take the high dimension size kernels to the end, and In a breakpoint, it uses different rate of convolution to get smaller kernels. But while doing that, it still keeps the bigger size, bigger dimension kernels to the alongside with smaller size kernels. After each breakpoint, here it uses different rays of convolution to get the context or segmentation information. It also add them up together with and it also add them together to get more information. It keeps going like this. The deeper you go, the smaller kernels you reach, and you connect them to get more information. At first, it sounds like it really needs more computational power than other networks, but in reality, it's not really, because it doesn't use complex calculations like, let's say, residual networks, because ResNet, in short, uses too many complex calculations to get the context of the segmentation information. I want to put one of the benchmark results here because I want to show why I choose DeepLab and HRNet. This is not about my thesis. This is just the cityscape test set results. And you can see that these are not pure HRNet or pure DeepLab, but their variants are really taking high spots on the list. These networks are used for, let's say, self-driving cars, and semantic segmentation in this kind of setting is really important for the future of the self-driving cars. So these benchmarks are really important. At this part, I would like to talk about my data set. My data set collected in some part of my data set collected in Akdeniz University Hospital in this setting. Children with epilepsy illness are, monitored during their hospital visits because of their complaints. And we wanted to catch a moment they had a seizure. So we wanted to get eye images of them during the seizure. And I called that data set Bayes data set. And it contains around 300 images. In reality, I segmented around 2,000 images originally, but I kind of distilled them to 300 because images were either too low quality or they were too similar. They didn't add much to the table. The second data set I used came from United Eyes software. It's synthetic eye images. You cannot see any sample here because it's apparent that I forgot to put, but they are synthetic eye images, contains reflections and some outdoor properties. You can set it up to have indoor properties as well. I originally segmented around 5,000 synthetic images and also lowered their numbers down to around 900 because if we use too many of the one side of the data set, it might overpower or it might change the decision how neural network makes. So I reduced the numbers. And the last data sets I used for this thesis come from the MICHA data set. MICHA data set in long is Mobile Iris Challenge Evaluation. In 2018, I'm not sure about that, they had a competition about iris detection on the mobile devices, and they generated this really, good eye data set, because as you can see, it has both indoor and outdoor properties, reflection, glasses, makeup, and that sort of thing that make the eye segmentation challenging. I also wanted to use different resolutions to see whether it affects the results or not, because I had chance. Oh, by the way, you can see the synthetic images. They look so realistic that I forgot that they are synthetic. Then I said that I forgot to put them. These are my Bayes data set. As you can see, Bayes dataset is the most challenging one because it's usually have low lightning conditions, and in low lightning conditions, people with dark iris, you cannot really distinguish iris with pupil with the people of really dark irises. Also, the angles and the lightning really differs from image to image. So I wanted to see if I use my Bayes dataset alongside with this additional data, can I get any performance increase or not? So I want to move on to my experiments. I think I explained my problem and my methods truly. So I wanted to see how network behaves on different conditions. You can see my setting here. I don't want to repeat it. You can just read if you want, if you are interested in this sort of stuff. Most of the time I use Google Collapse networks, notebooks, because when I use my own computer, it limited me because I had lower specs and I also couldn't be able to use my computer for my other work I need to do daily. So I use online service, Google Collapse notebooks. They usually have GPU of how it varies actually. It can be 20 gigabytes or it can be 12 gigabytes. But I wanted to, I tried to keep the batch size same for each experiment to make sure that there is no unfairness in batch sizes or at least the memory efficiency, because I'm not sure that each notebook I connected has the same specs or not. First thing I tested was effect of the shuffling. Effect of the shuffling, which means that for each epoch of the network, what does mean is when we are moving along in the neural networks, we are taking our training data and we need to check each training data separately. After we finish one cycle of our training set, that is called an epoch. For during an epoch, I wanted to see one epoch after an epoch, if I change the change the order, whether I get a performance increase or not. Actually, that's a common knowledge. You will get a performance increase with the shuffling because you get data in different contexts and different combinations. And results are also supported that I get huge increase in validation results. So I also want to test two optimizers. One is called Adam. It's really self-sustainable optimizer. It doesn't require too much high tuning because its learning rate changes with time and it tries to find the optimal solution using different weights. And the other one is Momentum. Actually, if I want to say SGD with Momentum, because stochastic gradient descent is said to be always reach best results with given time. But the problem with gradient descent is it takes too much time. So in order to solve that, they introduced a method called Momentum, which is really changes the, really tries to fasten the finding that optimal result. But in practice, actually results may or may not differ that much. I tested Adam and Momentum with different learning rates to see whether it creates a massive difference. And my experiments show that Adam with learning rate of 10 to the power of minus 4 created really good results, and this might be due to the variation of the initialization of the weights, because each time we try to train a network, weights are initialized in a different way. So Each time we train a network from a scratch, we will expect it to get a different result, but results are pretty similar. I mainly focused on validation results. And due to that, I picked Adam because it didn't require any tuning. I didn't need to worry about my data set size to change the learning rate. So at this part of my experiments, I try to find the what sort of difference batch size creates. With using my existing data sets, well, by the way, all data set means that my old data sets, they are combined. With using different sized data sets with different size batch size, I wanted to see if it creates a massive difference between the results. Actually, results were kind of unexpected for me. I expected bigger batch size to create a better results, but in reality, smaller batch sizes created better results. To be frank, I don't know why, but still, the bigger batch size of 5 worked faster for me, and difference was not that huge, and it sometimes batch size of 5 outperformed batch size of 2. So I move along my other experiments with batch size of 5. But we can say that batch size between 2 and 10 works fairly well for the small or mid-sized data sets, because you know, neural network data sets can go over a million, millions of images. And my data set is fairly small one. I can just use batch sizes between 2 and 10. So make it more visible, I just marked the best results I got. In this part, I experimented with augmentation. I rotated and changed brightness values of the images and played with them. I don't need to explain each operation I made, but I separated them into 3 categories: minimum augmentation, mid-level augmentation, and max-level augmentation. By augmentation, we are generating new images from existing images, and that's a great way to expand your database size, and it also helps with the prevent overfitting. So, but augmentation can also create a variance between your data set, and too much augmentation can create unnecessary noise with your data set, so you need to be careful with that. And due to that, I get best results with augmentation, minimum amount of augmentation without changing the variance too much. So for my next experiment, I kept augmentation min as a standard. Here we have a huge table, and that's one of the summary what I made about this thesis. You need to remember that almost each of these experiments took hours of training, and I made several of them to make sure of consistency, because, you know, if you run a neural network a single time, you might get a best or the worst result you can get with that network. So at least I try to run them 5 times to get some sort of average result, because, you know, that's at least more scientific. If I could, I would like to run them 100 times, but I don't have that kind of computational power. I had 2 patterns with this. HRNet and DeepLab, most of the time, outperformed their peers, their more primitive, competitors. But some of the results are not that different, because That might be due to the data set size. That might be due to the way I trained networks. But even if those big game neural networks are not outperforming the more primitive ones with huge margin, so that helped me to get some idea about these networks. But I want to make sure that their performance really, doesn't matter that much in cross settings, because without cross setting, we are using reference for each data set. And due to that, maybe each network had enough information to generalize the problem. Next experiment and the last experiment made with in a cross setting, which means that when we are talking about the cross base, training set contains all images beside base data set, and validation set contains only base data set. So the network has no idea about the base data set. This shows the generalization capabilities of the each networks. So here we also get consistent results with the previous experiment. And here, time to time, DeepLab and HRNet outperformed their peers in a significant margin. You can see that here almost 0.1 difference between VGGU net and HRNet. And you can see here really significant difference between HRNet and VGGNet and their variants. So in cross settings, those networks really performed in better in validation settings. But if we check the training results, we don't see that much of difference between the results. Let's take a look at the old data set. When we are take a look at these mean intersection over union values, we are taking at the training results, and we are seeing that they are almost identical. Yes, DeepLab version 3 plus and HRNet outperformed their peers, but they are also more expensive to train. They might not have as much as parameters as VGGUNet, but we most of the time modern computers doesn't have problem with a few megabits of information because we have gigabytes of data storage. So that brings me to my conclusions. In this experiment, I tested different networks to see in with the eye segmentation problems to see how they will perform. Also, I wanted to see how well images are segmented. I will read this part. In this thesis shown that eye segmentation tasks can be achieved using deep neural networks. In restrained conditions or the visible or good images, even without using infrared cameras or special equipment, I get really good results. And for the eye segmentation, if a small data set being used, batch sizes of 2 is shown to be beneficial. Yes. Even today, sometimes I make different experiments. I still see batch size of 2 is working well with small data sets. Just avoid using a batch size of 1, because in that setting, you are enforcing network for a overfitting, because you are not showing any combination of data. For optimizers, you can't go much wrong with any optimizer. Adam or Momentum or any other optimizers will work fairly well. But when this might matter, as if you are asking for a neural network enthusiast, maybe if you are trying to get a benchmark result for a data set, you might need to fine-tune your network to get your best result, maybe improve your performance 1 or 2%. You might need to change your learning rate. You might need to add learning rate decay, you might need to add some weight decay to get the best performance of the networks. In my test, I didn't see any negative effect of the additional data. At worst, they didn't improve our results, but they helped us to increase our variance without getting any negative performance. Networks shown similar results suggest that when we are trying to solve a segmentation or maybe object detection or maybe that sort of problem, instead of focusing too much on the network we use, we rather need to focus on the data set we are using. Improving data set will bring much more performance rather than the network fine-tuning. That should be the last thing you are doing. And the promising results I got from this thesis shows that maybe in the future, neural networks can be used for iris recognition. Also, you can use it for eye movement detection. Maybe any problem you have with eye can be solved with eye segmentation using deep neural networks. Alongside with my findings, I also shared my data set with researchers to make their own tests to see whether they get consistent results with me or they just want to solve other problems. You can use those data sets. That was my I think that's all. Thank you for listening. Sorry, I didn't follow any script, so maybe I little bit drifted the problem, but thank you. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer.
All right. Well done. Good. So does anyone have any questions? So, Seth, you've been commenting some about the small batch sizes. That was interesting to me as well. So it seemed like kind of the batch size of one was not good, but it kind of like did much better towards that middle range of batch sizes. But then the large batch size of 10 didn't work very well, correctly? Am I correct in that?
Yes, it's for my small data set, maybe around 1,000 images, it didn't work that well.
But also a batch size of one didn't work at all. It didn't work well either.
That's expected because that enforces overfitting. You want to show multiple data together with different orders to get the best results of your network.
Right. Gotcha. Does anyone have any questions or comments?
I have a question. Hello?
Okay. Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. So I have a question. Now, you have three data sets and you combine them.
Yes.
Did you combine them before splitting into training, validation, and test? Or did you split them into each one into training, validation, and test, and then combine the training ones with each other and the test with each other?
Actually, I combined them in both training and validation data sets. Also, as you said, I made experiments with a single data set alone to see how they performed. I think I should have a slide about it. Yes, here with using Bayes neural network, I wanted to get a Bayes result about each network so that I can compare when they are all combined. In this part, I have results of the each separate database in all data sets. Actually, these results are derived from all data sets. So I wanted to also compare their relation. I also, as you said, use them in cross setting without with separating one data set from other. I made tests to see how the networks will perform. I use them in any settings I could, I think. I wanted to use them as variant as possible. Yes, I don't have anything else to say.
Okay. So we are, I think we're out of time for this presentation, actually. So let's let me go ahead and end the recording there. Thank you very much, Melie.